Hey guys, this is the 224 Predator billet rod of Wildcat flat top piston build we did. And I've got the billet flywheel in. We're going to try getting this thing installed on here. And you can get a box to put my stuff in. I'm going to try to run these out of here real quick. There's just four bolts on this side cover, this blower housing, pull start cover, whatever you want to call it. Two at the top and two at the bottom. They're all 8mm. It's real easy. If you watched some of the other videos, you've probably already seen this. I'll just whip them out of here and get them out of the way. This is one of the big challenges, has been trying to set the camera up where you guys can see and I can see too. All right. Just leave that hooked up. Just set it over out of the way. I got to do some more work on that stop switch anyway. It's still got part of the old oil shutdown units hooked up to it. Now that came off easy. Hey, yeah, that's not good. Well, there won't be no plastic between the flywheel nut and the billet flywheel, that's for sure. Now, if you remember the last time when we did on the engine build video, I lapped this old cast iron flywheel in and put it on temporarily just so we could get this thing started and I could run it a little bit. Now, these aren't too bad. Now, I'm not going to put a puller on here or anything. I'm just going to put a little pressure behind the flywheel and screw the nut on there so I don't mess up and hit a thread. And I'm going to tap it with a hammer. And you'll find once you've got a lapped fit, I'm going to watch out for that coil too. Once you've got a lapped fit, it don't take much. You can, you know, if you move it 10 thousandths, it'll pop off the taper. So that's all it takes. Now, when I first disassembled this engine, the flywheel was loose on the taper, and I was worried that it messed it up, but it hadn't. I think it was okay. But yeah, that's tightening down a plastic. Now this is the billet flywheel. This is the Slipstream, and it's got the, well, I guess they call them neodymium magnets on there. Those things are really hot too. I mean, they're powerful. But it's a good looking outfit. And the reason, here's the part number SK200. Is the part number, and it's just a Honda clone billet flywheel. So any clone flywheel should work on this. Now I'm going to use the Permatex valve grinding compound. You know, I prefer using the Clover brand, but this is okay. It's at the other shop, and so I just ran over to auto parts store the other day and picked up some of this cheap crap. And we're going to do the same thing we did to the stock flywheel in part three, I think it was, of this engine build. Just going to put a generous amount on the flywheel, the crank taper. And we're going to put some on the inside of the flywheel taper. And since I don't know how far this taper is going to reach across, I'm going to make sure I put the valve grinding compound all across, well, on both sides of the taper. Make sure it's all the way across, because I don't know how far it's going to go. I'm sure it won't go all the way, but you know, if it does, hey, we'll have it covered. And slip it over the crankshaft. Get over there. Oh, let's get this coil off first. This flywheel is a little bit larger diameter than stock. Wasn't expecting that. Width-wise, I think we're looking pretty good, though, even from the start here. And one of the reasons I wanted to go ahead and get this, I'll zip this coil off real quick. I wanted to get this Slipstream flywheel because I thought if there's one that probably won't work, it'll be it. So anything else should work. And I'll set this coil up here. If it'll stay up there out of the way. Nope, get back up there. Stay. And it's going to slip the flywheel on. Just turn her left and right on, let her grind on the taper. You can hear that grit. Well, that magnet's strong, it's grabbed it a little. And when it stops feeling like it's gritting heavy, just pull it back a little bit and put it back up on the taper and grind her some more left and right. It don't take long, you know, just a minute or two. You'll get a good lapped fit. This one's already, it's starting to turn the crankshaft a little bit. You can tell by how it feels, you know, most of the time. It seems like you start, it starts gritting a little less, you know, as you go, so. Couple minutes, and I think that's about it. Yeah, that's probably going to be okay by the time I get that cleaned off and give it a look-see. Now I'm just using just part of an old flannel shirt here. Shop towels are getting hard to come by here lately without the ones that not got any oil on them anyway. And I'm going to spray some of my cheap carb cleaner in there and try to get all that grit and crap out so I can get a look and see what we got going on here. So far, that's looking pretty decent. Yeah, I think we may have it. I'll finish cleaning the rest of this grit out. Yeah, that taper does not go all the way across. But that's okay. That's good. That means this flywheel is pretty wide, so that's good. I don't see any problem with this thing working out. Just like last time, we're going to clean the grit off of that taper and clean the grit out of those threads. Make sure you get it out of that keyway. And when I clean this, you know, I'm making sure I'm using an oil-free rag here and with the carb cleaner because I don't want any oil on this taper. No kind of lubrication whatsoever because we were going to make that a pressed, lapped, machined fit. And we don't want any oil in there. Yeah, I hope this carb cleaner doesn't do something to my aluminum, but it don't matter. Let's see. Yeah. Oh, that's looking good. Try to hold it up here where you guys can see if it'll focus right. Yeah, it's got a good lap all the way around. And no, it doesn't go all the way through. See the shiny part of the bore there? Yeah, that's where we haven't lapped. Yeah, it's looking good. And I'm satisfied that crankshaft is looking lapped in too. Yeah, that's what you want right there. Looking good. Just like that. Now, you got a choice. God, you can run a key if you want. And, you know, that's fine. I don't. But it's your choice. I had some issues with an engine that was kicking backwards on me on the compression stroke when it would shut down years ago. And I ruined a couple of billet flywheels, and some other guys racing with me had problems too with those timing keys. So I'd rather just run a lapped flywheel without a key and delete the key. Now, when I put mine on, now what I'm going to do, I'm going to advance it about 1/4 of the key slot. And that's what I'm planning on doing is, now I don't know how much advance this flywheel has got in it or not. So I'm going to go ahead and run about 1/4 of the slot advanced. And we're going to try that first and see how that works out. Now, I'm be running some, this engine's going to be running on gasoline, and I do have a little additive in there, too, to help it out. But now once I get that flywheel up here where I want it, I'm just going to tap it with a couple small light taps with a hammer. And that's just to hold it in place while I get the, I'm going to verify, yeah, I'm still where I want to be on my key slot. So that's just going to hold that flywheel in place on that taper until I get the starter cup. Now, that's got an indention. That cup goes in that indention. Yeah, when I get the starter cup and the flywheel nut on there, should be good to go. But the reason I tap that flywheel, just kind of hold it in place on the taper so it doesn't move until I get this thing tightened down. There we go. Yeah, they put these long starter cups on there. I can't figure out why they extended the blower housing out so far. And yeah, I'm just going to run this up with the impact, guys. I don't put a torque on just as hard, tight as I can get it, you know. If you want to put a torque wrench on yours, I'm sure they want you to from the factory to torque them down to a certain spec. But I just run mine with an impact. So, you know, follow the manufacturer's recommendations. They might not necessarily like what I'm doing. We'll get this coil started back on here. Yep, maybe. Yeah, turn it a little bit so you guys can see a little better. And with these really hot magnets on these flywheels, usually I run, you know, between 40 and 50 thousandths air gap on my coil. Because, you know, when I was racing those Briggs, you know, I had some hot magnets on some of those flywheels. And, you know, I was running, you know, probably about a 20,000th coil gap, air gap on those. And I noticed, you know, after about 30 or 40 laps, started getting some running issues. And what happened, I was started burning up my coils. So you want to put a little extra space between your coil and these hot magnets. Because believe me, they will burn up your coil if you get it too close. And probably, you know, 45, 50 is, I don't know if that's far enough away, but, you know, that's where I'm going to run it at. Now, I've got this waxed, or not waxed, but laminated paper. It's showing about 46 thousandths. This is just some of the stuff that came with the engine, one of those tags, laminated tags. And I've got it folded over twice, so it's actually four layers of that laminated paper. But comes up, you know, a little over 40 some thousandths. And that's about right. Yeah. Between 45 and 50 is what I try to shoot for. Yeah. Run these up here a little closer. And what I'm going to do, guys, I've got, I know you can't hardly see when I've got it. My ring finger is poking down into the mounting hole of the block down there. And I've got my thumb pressing against the coil, and it's pushing it against the flywheel, trying to squish that paper if I can. And now I'm just going to snug these down good. See if I can get this paper out of there. Yeah, that looks okay. I think that'll work. Now I'm going to install this full start blower housing back on here. And I went ahead and started the bolts because I don't think you guys want to watch me start four bolts. You know where they go. But I'll show you me tightening them up anyway. Two up top here under the tank. Snug them down good. And two down here at the bottom. And again, these are all 8mm. All right. Now let me get this thing out of the way. Still got to do something with that. And let's mount this header back. I keep switching it back and forth between the between this, the billet rod engine and the Hemi engine we did the other day. Still got that terrible flange on there that I'm going to cut off and replace. But for now, it seems to be working okay. So I'll just, you know, we'll get to that later. There we go. And now let's see what we got here. Switch on. Oh. Oh, I don't think my compression release is working. I know it's not. All right. Yeah. Oh no. All right, let's get these valves adjusted. And I'm just gonna go ahead and do that off camera, guys, and get back over here to you. Now let's give it a try. A little high. Try to get that set a little better. Oh, that's rich. A little black smoke there. That 125 jet's way too rich. Oh yeah. I'd say it works. And that's about all I got for you guys today. It works. Thanks for hanging out with me. We'll see you next time.